Excuse me. Steve Case is the chairman and CEO of Revolution, co-founder of American Air Online, and chairman of the Case Foundation, accomplished entrepreneur, philanthropist, member of President Obama's Council on Jobs and Competitiveness, and I'd also note a valued and valuable member of the Smithsonian Institution's Board of Regents. Mr. Case, please go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Senator Leahy. It's an honor to serve with you on that Smithsonian Board of Regents, and it's also an honor to be invited to speak to you and the committee today. I want to share my perspective on an issue that I think is central to our history and also critical to our future. I appear before you today as an entrepreneur, an investor, a civic leader, and a colleague and friend of talented immigrant entrepreneurs and innovators who devote themselves to their companies and contribute to this country. To understand this debate in context, it is necessary to remember that the story of America is in part the story of entrepreneurs who settled this land seeking a better life and through grit, hard work, and creativity built companies, cities, and whole new industries that power the strongest economy the world has ever known. Our country did not become the world's leading economy by luck or accident. Iconic Fortune 500 companies that employ thousands of Americans did not simply come to be. Revered American cities like New York, Chicago, and Los Angeles did not sprout up by chance. New industries for telephones, airplanes, and the internet were not conceived by happenstance. It was the work of pioneering entrepreneurs, beginning with the country's earliest settlers, our nation's first immigrant entrepreneurs, who took a risk hoping to turn dreams into startup businesses. From the earliest days, immigrant entrepreneurs started some of America's most celebrated enterprises: U.S. Steel, Pfizer, Kraft Foods, Honeywell, Goldman Sachs, AT&T, and Yahoo were all started by immigrants. Today, 40% of Fortune 500 companies in the United States were started by immigrants or children of immigrants, 40%. Between 1995 and 2005, half of Silicon Valley startups had an immigrant founder. And this is not just about technology companies. When Hamdi Ulukaya, an immigrant from Turkey, hired four employees to begin packaging yogurt by hand in upstate New York, his friends thought it was a crazy idea. 8 years later, Chobani Yogurt generates $1 billion in sales, has hired 1,500 American workers, and is expanding operations all across the country. Mr. Chairman, high-skilled immigrants have always been job creators, not job takers. The mistake that opponents of immigration reform often make is believing that our society and economic growth are zero-sum. They are not. More talented immigrants joining the American family does not equate to fewer jobs, it equates to more jobs. Others argue that instead of allowing more high-skilled immigrants to stay, we should instead focus on better training and STEM education for America's youth. But this is a false choice. We can and must do both: draw the best and brightest from across the globe and develop more talented students here at home. But every year, arbitrary immigration caps force approximately one-third of the 50,000 foreign-born STEM graduates from our universities to leave the country. If our military had such a policy, we would train soldiers, sailors, and pilots at West Point, the Naval Academy, and the Air Force Academy, only to then send them away to join the militaries of other nations. I think we'd all agree that that would be crazy. But our immigration policy, particularly around high-skilled immigrants, is equally crazy. Meanwhile, as we as a nation grow somewhat complacent about the global battle for talent, our global competitors are stepping up their game. China launched the 1,000 Talents program to attract talented researchers back to the country. Australia grants nearly as many employment-based green cards as the United States, despite having an economy that's 14 times smaller. Canada recently announced a new startup visa program that grants permanent residency to foreign-born innovators who receive backing from Canadian investors. But sadly, here in the United States, we are making it harder for innovators to come and to stay. A few months ago, I was having breakfast with a group of young entrepreneurs in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, when I met Deepak, a young up-and-coming star in the Research Triangle area. Deepak was born in India, has a PhD in genetics from the University of North Carolina, and his healthcare startup has achieved 40% month-over-month growth. Yet his green card status remains uncertain, and as a result, Deepak is having difficulty convincing investors to fund his expansion. Deepak is ready to hire more employees in Raleigh. Instead, he waits. And there are stories like this all over the country. A few decades ago, we lost ground in the manufacturing sector when we failed to respond aggressively to global competition. We cannot afford to do the same when it comes to the entrepreneurial sector. The good news is that numerous bipartisan high-skilled immigration proposals have been teed up in recent months that contain smart reforms. The Startup Act permits entrepreneurs and STEM graduates to stay and start businesses. The I-Squared Act increases the amount of available green cards and removes the per-country cap for employment-based visas. The Startup Visa Act allows foreign entrepreneurs to move to the United States as long as they have financial backing. The Smart Jobs Act slows the STEM brain drain by adding a new non-immigrant F-4 visa. Chairman Leahy has introduced a compelling idea based on the EB-5 program that's working in his home state of Vermont. President Obama has called for stapling green cards to the diplomas of American-educated immigrants with STEM degrees. And the bipartisan Gang of Eight, including many in this room, has agreed on a framework to admit the skilled workers necessary for a competitive economy. I defer to the men and women on Capitol Hill and at the White House to determine which specific provisions make up the final plan, but this much is clear. We must enact measures that enable talented entrepreneurs to start businesses here in the United States. For over a decade, there has been a discussion of the need to update our laws and give our country the tools to win the global battle for talent. And yet nothing has happened. At this critical time, I believe the best way to win adoption of high-skilled immigration reforms is to make them part of a comprehensive immigration reform package that also addresses a path to citizenship for undocumented workers living in our country, deals with border security, and also sanctions on employers who break the law. Such a comprehensive package is essential, not only for its potential to spur our economic growth, but because it also can address the family and human issues that are also at stake in this emotional debate. And with the leadership in the Senate, and this committee in particular, it can get done. A few months ago, I stood next to President Obama and Republican Majority Leader Eric Cantor in the Rose Garden after they joined together to pass the Jobs Act, Jumpstarting Our Business Startups Act, on behalf of our nation's entrepreneurs. Pundits said it would never happen, particularly given it was an election year. But it did. Bipartisan progress is possible during moments in Washington when diverse groups of citizens call for action. On immigration, this is the moment for Democrats, Republicans, and Independents to come together and pass comprehensive reform. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you for your time.